Oh, here he comes. Come on, welcome our host, Rolf Najork.
Hello everybody, I'd like to welcome you to the Factory of the Future show today here in Berlin. I think we have a very private but very exclusive audience here, so we'll do our best to really make you feel good and have a good experience here. We have chosen a different format than usual because we not only want to inform you, we also want to entertain you a bit. So we have chosen the format of a late night show. I hope you will like it. It's the concept of Eric Snowden. He will sit in the first row. If you don't like it, because we are a no-blame culture, go to him and talk to him later on. Yeah. So he's the Dutch guy, very few hair on his head, and permanently talking about football in the presence of Germans. So, however, like a good factory, we always have to maintain two things that we have in perfect shape. One of which is we have to get customer feedback. And secondly, we have to deliver on time, particularly today. For that, I have two wonderful colleagues. It's Yin and Mette.
Hello, everyone.
So, thank you both. But now it's the time to get started. And how could we better start the session without, let's say, an introduction to what we said last year? Because last year we were here on stage and we presented to you the vision of the factory of the future. Not everybody has seen it, so we give you a short recap. Let's go. Factory of the future, it basically consists of three elements. That is the intelligent smart building of the future. That's the basis of the factory of the future. In the factory of the future, there are exactly six things that are fixed. Four walls, the ceiling, and the floor. Anything else is totally mobile. This factory is totally connected. All information are going wireless. We are convinced it can become real and it will become real. So what's next? And next means to me in the course of this year and next year. We will have to have much more customer focus. It's not relevant what we can do technically. It's relevant what the customer likes and what delivers real benefit to them. And the only way for us to defend our business is if we can bring this digital work in conjunction with our domain competence on manufacturing. So I think the world will be a different place when it comes to digitalization. We have to drive the market, we have to shape it. The factory of the future is our answer to this question. Will it come 100% as I show to you? You know the answer. This is a way, this is a direction, we're moving this direction. We will take deviations, changes, turns as we move on. But we are convinced that this can be the final goal. And we're testing it out with a number of customers these days, and the customers like it a lot. Yeah, that was last year's show. But as I said, we are moving on today. We want to show you in three sections how we're moving on. We got some interesting guests. First of all, we have three topics for you. First section is about intelligent factory and equipment. The second section will deal with the IT aspect and will particularly deal with manufacturing and logistics. And in the third section, we have some very interesting guests that tell you how data will change their manufacturing processes and make them more successful. But that's enough for the setup, Mette. Who's our first guest?
Yes, our first guest on stage. Let's first go into the factory. All right, now we are in the factory of the future. So our first guest kicks off the first topic, which is the intelligent factory and equipment. And he's from Rexroth. So first, let's see his introduction movie. Yes? Good. Please welcome on stage Thomas Fechner, Head of Innovations at Bosch Rexroth. Hello, Thomas.
Thank you. Hi, Rolf.
Hi, Thomas.
Good nice to have you here. Why don't you take a seat? Yeah?
I do.
So, Thomas, good to have you here. I have some questions for you. I think we saw some wonderful pictures today from this year's Hannover Trade Fair, where we saw really that we're bringing this vision to life. You can see a lot of these features, and Thomas will give us some information about it. You're heading the innovations department at Bosch Rexroth. You're dealing with factory of the future. A lot of people here, particularly the hard nodes manufacturing people, will think this is all about science fiction. Is it, or are there real products?
Yeah, Rolf, it's of course no science fiction. You see it on a picture. We have products already in place. So in the factory of the future, it's all about reconfiguration, flexibility, and modularization. And we discovered that all in the marketplace who have products there and bring them in the market, dealing basically with three things. The first is that the products and the solutions become connective. This sounds familiar to everybody of you, but to bring it alive, it's really hard. You have to make it industry-proof, and you have to make it cost-effective. And by this, you can differentiate. And the second thing is that we see if these systems appear, that the automation pyramid is dissolving. This we are talking since years about, but now it happens. The second major trend is the robotization. We saw already this morning. There is on one hand the robots, industrial robots, which like to escape the cage. And on the other hand, we see a massive robotization in intralogistics. Therefore, we have products as seen in the short introduction movie. Yeah, and then there's the third innovation. A pillar coming up, it's more the economic side. We see new business models rising, and it's really an interesting journey we take.
Okay. You spoke about robotics. I think we see more and more the vision of having cobots, of having interaction between robots and humans. What are you expecting in this area? How do you see this in the future?
Yeah, we saw already that we have, as Bosch, a product. The APAS was shown this morning by Michael Bolle. So we get the first experience. And if it comes to collaborative robots, it's all about safety on one hand and on information of the user on the other side. Safety is straightforward. We are talking about sensors and the right architecture. So this we are quite familiar as Bosch. The interesting point is more the information, and this comes to user experience. And as better the operator can foresee what will happen in the manufacturing, as more he feels comfortable with these new automation technologies. So in thinking this completely through, we came up with the idea of an intelligent floor, which displays the operator upcoming reconfigurations in the manufacturing or material displays.
Yeah. You heard intelligent floor, which means inductive charging, information transformation, and sensing functionality. That I would call really an innovation. And we have prototyped it the first time on Hannover Trade Fair. I think it was an absolute industry first that we presented in this case.
Exactly.
Okay, come to the next question. You mentioned intralogistics. What are you working on in intralogistics?
Okay, straightforward, we brought the shuttle, the active shuttle, in life. It's now available. These systems, if you look technology-wise, of course, are fully autonomous. What we're discussing on the road, we have it now in the manufacturing side. These systems get all the perception inside. They come along with changing environment and make their navigation there. Mm-hmm. To make the systems a success, the introduction is quite important. So we are talking about 1 to 2 hours setup time for such systems to make them operative if you have them first in your hand, besides having weeks of engineering integration at the moment, still at the moment in the places. So therefore, our system is quite optimized. A second topic, or a third topic then, is the ROI, so the cost, the price point for the customer. There we see ROI calculations quite often below 2 years, what spreads the systems at the moment massively. And this is important for us because this is one of the central enablers for the factory of the future. By having these systems, we can break the rigid and hard-coded material flows of today.
Very exciting. It really doesn't sound like science fiction. I think it becomes pretty concrete. We are delivering on that. We will see applications now coming out. We saw some nice pictures. Now, what about hydraulics? Is it an old-fashioned technology? Will it be part of factory of the future?
Yeah, it is one of our core, the hydraulics. Of course, not the robustness of this technology and the power density inside. It's absolutely not reachable with other technologies. So it will stay as an important pillar in the factory of the future as well. But we see that there is a different appearance in future. Mm-hmm. So today you have quite heavy installations, central installations of power supply, hydraulic power supply. This will modularize and the HPUs will go more toward the processes and machines. You will not see them so much. And the second trend in is that we see much more electrohydraulics. So the hydraulics become self-contained. You will not see it. It's even maintenance-free for the user.
I think it's interesting information. What it means is you will only have an electric wiring into hydraulic. All the hydraulic is closed, and you cannot differentiate from the outside whether it's hydraulics or electromechanics or whatever. That will be the trend you're looking for.
Exactly.
Thank you very much, Thomas. Big applause to Thomas.
Thank you.
So, let's come to the next guest, because we do not just invent everything on our own, as you can imagine. What we're doing, we collaborate. And one of the big collaborations we have on stage here, Mette, who is our next guest?
Yes, thank you, Rolf. Our next guest is coming from BigRep. Let's welcome Stephan Beyer, CEO of BigRep, on the stage. Welcome.
Hello, Stephan. Nice to have you here. He's our first external speaker, and he brought something.
So this is, well, first of all, thanks for having me in the show, and I'm excited to see so many people in the room here. This is our Nera bike, and I thought I'd bring it for you for your to share in the company and for your desk.
Yeah, thank you very much, Stephan. Please come with me and take a seat.
Hi, Stephan. Hey.
And we'll be moving on with some questions. Stephan, you have a development partnership with Rexroth, is that right?
Yeah, we did. And so one of the examples that we did, where we started a very concrete work with an AGV, so an autonomous guided vehicle. And we worked very closely with the people at Bosch Rexroth to come up with something revolutionary that is lightweight, is able to bury the same load, but at the same time, fully flexible in the functionality and connected.
And this we showed at Hannover?
Yes, definitely we did, and it created a lot of excitement. We were very happy to see it, and we see it as one element that creates also the factory of the future.
Yeah. So this is an example on how you work in a different way in large-scale 3D printing. Yeah, you could see this is a gift, and the motorbike I was coming in on was also made from the same printer. I get newer designs are important, but what are the economic benefits?
So one thing is clear, if there's no economic benefit, there's no use case for the customer, and then this technology would not make any sense. The benefit comes from many parts. Well, first of all, it's certainly the design, but we need to be very creative in using the potential of the technology, not thinking in the old ways, but coming up with innovation, how a future design creates new value for our customers. And that can be very, very different in different industries. And this is just one example of how we're doing it.
Now we come to the key question of 3D printing. You probably have heard it many times before. 3D printing is looked upon as a typical manufacturing technology for prototypes. Can it become a serial production technology? And why, and what is different then?
So, yes, the answer must be yes, because I started this business 5 years ago with the vision to bring 3D printing to the industrial world. And we believe that there's a great potential of disrupting industries. So what we need to do is to redefine value chains with our customers, changing the way business is done, breaking it down to innovations that have something meaningful, that create a competitive advantage with our customers so that they can sustain on a global market. And this is the potential from our point of view that is behind additive manufacturing. So there's a way to go, that's for sure, and it needs close cooperation. It also needs a technology behind it that allows us to print fast at high speed. This is at the core of our cooperation. Mm-hmm. You know, we bring an extruder, Bosch Rexroth technology in it, and this gives us a clear competitive advantage, but it's not only the machine that counts, it's the application behind the machine, the value it creates for the customer, and this is what's helping the technology breakthrough.
What can the additive industry as a whole do in the future, particularly when we look into the factory of the future?
Yeah, so when we look into the factory of the future, from what we hear from our customers, we have 350 customers worldwide, big automotive companies, big aviation companies, machine building companies. What they look for is a reliable production technology at lot size one. Why is this important? Because this gives them the competitive advantage on a global scale. Even the Chinese understand why this is so important. So in order to bring this to the market, we need close cooperations. And this is why we're teaming up with Bosch Rexroth here to bring this to our customers. And the market is ready, it's open for it. People do understand the potential behind the technology.
Yeah, thank you very much. Big applause to Stephan. I think he gave us a good insight into 3D printing with the perspective of integrating it into mass manufacturing. And he's a lucky guy because he chose the right partner to do that.
Yeah. We did.
Okay, thank you very much. You stay a seat, please. So we come to our next guest. Both of you, you know him because we're working in interactions, as I said. The next guest is a guest which comes from the Arena 2036 Meta.
Yes. Is it? So our final guest on this topic one, the intelligent factory and equipment, is coming from Bosch Corporate Research. Come on, Matthias.
And Matthias, nice to have you here. Please take a seat. Yeah?
Hey.
So also for Matthias, we have some questions. And let's start with the Arena itself as a construction. Why the Arena? What is it doing? What are you fighting for? With whom?
Mm-hmm. Arena 2036 is a collaborative research environment based in Stuttgart. It's exploring not only the design and engineering specific to automobiles, but also and more generally many aspects for the factory of the future. We want to make the factories fit to future requirements. Our major goals for Arena are to anticipate the future. That means to understand what's coming, to develop better products for sure, and to investigate how our products can interact better. Mm-hmm. And we don't do that alone. Mm-hmm. We met several strong partners at Arena, mm-hmm. currently around 30, and we work closely together.
Very good. On a scale between now and the future, what would you say the Arena deals with?
Using the Rexroth timescale of now, next, and beyond, I would say we have a little bit of next and mostly beyond. Mm-hmm. So we continuously enhance our vision of the future by deriving requirements from future scenarios and future hypotheses. We design solutions to implement these requirements and finally bring them into our research demonstrator to make them tangible. This is how we work at Arena. And for the implementation, we use our own products as far as possible. We provide feedback afterwards to our product and application development teams and thereby bring the future to the present.
Isn't construction like the Arena too far away from customers' reality? It's probably an offense and a challenge that you get to hear all the time, huh?
No, that's a very good question. And I heard it before, actually. At a first glance, I would say the arena and the scenarios we explore look probably pretty far away from the reality in many of today's factories. However, we met quite a few factory operators during the last 1.5 years and learned in these discussions that our basic assumptions that lay the foundation of our visions are confirmed. So we are pretty sure we address real customer needs. Mm-hmm. And yeah, the major benefit of Arena for us is this collaboration aspect. So we have these strong partners, as I mentioned before, and many of the core technology building blocks we need for the factory of the future can be brought to life only with strong partners. Think about 5G, for example, or distributed ledger or device integration. For that reason, we are confident that Arena makes us faster at the end.
Yeah, and it worked well because they have been the strong co-inventor on this intelligent floor. And I think that is the first time when we saw it really coming up with a lot of contribution from your fellow colleagues in Arena. Final question. Give us a glimpse into the future. What is your very latest idea?
Mm-hmm. Allow me to come back to this example of the intelligent floor. As it's a nice example, besides a highly motivated team, the environment of Arena helped us a lot to transition the idea of the intelligent floor to the first working prototype. I would like to give some examples how that worked. Right at the beginning, after we had the IP secured, we integrated the first functional samples of this intelligent floor in our research demonstrator at Arena and made the vision tangible this way. This was very helpful for the discussion with internal and external stakeholders, and we got a lot of feedback on the prioritization of requirements. As a second example, we had to scale up the intelligent floor area-wise for our presentation at the Hannover Fair this year. And for the scale-up, we needed a distributed control system to control sensors and actuators in our floor. Based on POCs we made before at Arena, we knew one of the startup partners would be able to support us very well. So we partnered with these guys. They developed the control system for us, and we were able to scale up in only 10 weeks.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Matthias. Big applause to Matthias. And before we close the first section, I think we need to consider for a moment, we have heard about wonderful new technology. The most interesting thing about wonderful new technology is it's usually expensive, and it comes with huge investments in the plant. So when we're going into new technology, take the example of the 3D printer, we will have to find new ways of financing these modern factories. And one option is pay-per-use. Ying, what do we know about that?
Yes, I think we should better ask our audience how they think about pay-per-use. So now, audience, now there is a hand-up question for you. So if you already using pay-per-use in your work, let it be a machine, a tool, a robot, whatever, if you already use it, please let me see your hand. Okay, I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Rolf, I would say a little bit more than I expected. What do you think?
Yeah, I think we hardly saw anybody here. And,
in the middle.
I think, to be quite fair, obviously, pay-per-use hasn't arrived yet. We have promoted it. We have seen it in a session early on. But obviously, there's a way to go. Why is it so difficult? I would like to turn to my panelists. One sentence. What do we have to do to enable pay-per-use models in the future?
I think one major challenge for pay-per-use scenarios is if the responsibility for the process transitions from the factory operator to the process provider, if this is a more complex process. So we are working hard in research to make processes more controllable and thus go one step forward to pay-per-use.
Okay, Thomas?
Yeah, for us, it's pretty simple. We offer it, and we are convinced that if the first use it, the others see the advantages and will step on.
Stephan?
Well, our customers are not asking for that yet, but I think they will. So it's a question of explaining to them the value behind it, and it's going to happen, it's for sure.
Yeah, thank you very much. We got some answers. We are closing the first section here. A big applause to the panelists.
Thank you.
And I would like to say goodbye to you presenting this gift. Thank you very much for coming. Please take a seat in the very first row, and then we will move on. Mette.
Yes, so thanks to the guests in topic one. And just before we go to the next topic, which is shaping the future of manufacturing and logistics, we just want to show you a bit more about the active shuttle, as Thomas spoke about. So this is an actual technology. It's already available. And let's see more how it works. Welcome back from the commercials. So this is just a great little movie showing a bit more about the hardware in the factory of the future. But what about the software, Rolf?
Yeah, software will play a key role in the factory of the future. By the way, we get to see that now in a lot of customer discussions. To be able to shed a light at what we're doing here, we have invited a person from BCI. BCI is Bosch Connected Industry. We even in Bosch have founded a new area with a lot of software specialists, roughly 500, that are dealing with the software and the software control in the world of the factory of the future, but also in logistics and in the general manufacturing. So Mette, who is our next guest here?
Yes, our next guest we have invited is Sven Hammond. And he is the Senior Vice President of Bosch Connected Industries. So he will tell us more about how to shape the future of manufacturing and logistics. So just let's see his introduction movie first. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Sven Hammond on stage.
Hi, Sven.
Hi.
What? Good to have you here.
Thank you for the invitation.
Yeah. Sven, give us a presentation. We will hold it more in a traditional style, so the stage is yours. Go ahead, and we have some questions later on.
So, we are Bosch Connected Industry, and we are the brain of the factory of the future, because our software analyzes the data, builds up the knowledge out of the data, and then prepares decision making. And our software portfolio is called Nexseed, and with Nexseed we offer a holistic solution from the sensor to the cloud, and also over the whole value chain, from manufacturing to logistics. We eat what we cook. That is to say, our solutions are user-centered and based on the experience from manufacturing at Bosch. So we use these solutions in 280 manufacturing plants worldwide and with thousands of users every day. And these are the solutions that we offer to our customers. And let me give you now two examples. So in the factory of the future, you've seen that flexibility will increase significantly and also the variance in the product. So we have to keep still our processes stable and our high quality demand. Therefore, it will be key to analyze the process data and build up more knowledge about our processes. And this is what we do with an Exceed Production Performance Manager. And I would like to show you now one example, a cooperation we have with BMW. And in the picture in the back, you see the BMW plant in Landshut. This is a center of competence for electromobility and lightweight design in BMW. And we analyze with them together processes in the cockpit production. So processes of gluing, foaming, punching. So for example, in punching, we analyze the data of the punching process, build up a model of the process, and we're now for the first time able in real time to predict the wear of the cutting tools. And that enabled BMW to change to a dynamic maintenance model and prevent any downtimes of the machinery. And let me hand over now to two experts from BMW who can explain this much better than me.
Wir bei BMW produzieren nicht nur innovative Produkte, auch unsere Prozesse haben einen hohen Grad an Innovation an Bord. Deswegen sind wir immer auf der Suche nach Lösungen, um unsere Produktion weiter zu optimieren und eine permanente Steigerung der Transparenz in unseren Prozessen zu erreichen. In einer Proof-of-Concept-Phase haben wir zwei Systeme evaluiert und am Ende hat das Bosch-System uns überzeugt. Die Prozesskurvendarstellung des Production Performance Managers schafft hierbei eine Detaildarstellung unserer Qualitätskenngrößen, mit deren Hilfe wir frühzeitig drohende Probleme erkennen können. Die hohe Flexibilität und die von Haus aus mitgebrachte Funktionalität des Systems macht einen Use-Case-orientierten Einsatz bei uns problemlos möglich.
And if you are now curious to use the Production Performance Manager also on your plant, in my presentation I will add a link where you can have a free download for a test version and you will find it in the portal. As a second example, in the factory of the future, mobility will increase. So everything is mobile. The machines will move, the parts, the material, and it will become key to manage this flow. And this is what we do with an Exceed track and trace solution. And I want to show you here a cooperation project that we did with Knox. Knox is the European market leader of overnight delivery. So these are the guys who take care of all these urgent deliveries that have to arrive before morning at the production sites to prevent stop production there. And what we did, we equipped the containers from Knox with sensors, and we have an app where you can easily pair a transport job with a container. Then you get full transparency within your logistic hub and also on the complete transport way. And we offer an analytic solution where you can optimize the flow, for example, based on artificial intelligence. And if you want to get to know more about this use case, Mr. Rosenkranz, COO from Knox, will have a speech on the use case here on this stage at 2 o'clock. So have a look at that. So Bosch Connected Industry, we shape the factory of the future with solutions from manufacturing and logistics, because the intelligence of the factory of the future lies in its software and in the mind of its people. Thank you.
Thank you. Sven, please take a seat. So, please. Two questions, two short questions to you. First of all, the Industry 4.0 hype is cooling down a little bit. That is also, by the way, why we brought up the idea of Factory of the Future, to give it some new energy and some new dynamics in a holistic content. Have you managed to stay in the race, and what are you doing to stay on top of things in your competition?
Yeah, I hope we did much better than only staying in the race. We had growth rate of 30% to 40% in the last years. But I think we have some unique assets within Bosch that differentiate us from competitors. So on one side, as I said, we offer holistic solutions. So we offer from the sensor to the robots, the AGVs, up to the complete execution software system solution. And another asset is that our solutions are based on our own experience from manufacturing, and it's used daily in our own production plants, and this is what we offer.
That's something we experience very often when we go out in the field. Bosch is the manufacturing machine in the outside world. Actually, I had a meeting with a very famous CEO in China a few weeks ago, and he said, for us, there's two references for manufacturing, one of which is Japan,
and one of which is Europe, and they said, if it's Europe, it's Bosch. And I think what we have to do when we are selling products and we're going in exactly with the idea that you portrayed, we have to promote our know-how, our unique experience on a broad bandwidth of production to be able to be successful in the market and boost also our conventional products. And that is exactly what we're doing in BBI these days. We combine the features of the different products and try to come to a holistic product offering. Second question. What are the next big things in Industry 4.0 from your point of view?
I give you an insight of our innovation pipeline. Yeah? So as also Mr. Bolle said in the beginning, we will change from connected industry to intelligent industry. Mm-hmm. So artificial intelligence will be one of the key enablers for that. Mm-hmm. As Bosch Connected Industry, we work very closely with the Bosch Center for Artificial Intelligence to bring really top-notch research results into our products. Mm-hmm. And if we say we are the brain of the factory of the future, I think the central nervous system will become 5G. And we already do first pilot projects in our plants to enable their new services based on 5G. Mm-hmm. And perhaps the third example, if we want to enable business models between different platforms, I think the distributed ledger technology will be key. So we also run pilot projects on that. By the way, we do this in Arena 2036, as Matthias just mentioned. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Before you move on, I think it's time to involve the audience again. Yin.
Yes, Rolf. Now it's again a hand up question. So in this session, we heard a lot about softwares. We heard about NextSeed. We heard about production management system. And we heard about the track entries. So audience, who of you already be convinced that Rolf's software can be easily introduced also in your manufacturing and can really benefit your work? So if you are convinced of the benefit of Rolf's softwares, please let me see your hand. Wow, Rolf, I would say this is great.
I think the number is bigger than I expected, which is very good for him. Yeah, and we absolutely appreciate that. But I think it could be much bigger. I think it much better. Obviously, we have to do some better selling. And under these circumstances, I would like to ask Mr. Hölzmann on stage here, because Mr. Hölzmann is one of the most prominent and convinced NextSeed sellers in BCI. And you have now exactly 1 minute to double the number of customers here. You do your best. Don't exceed. I will shoot you.
Yeah? Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Dear ladies and gentlemen, would you like to increase the output of your machines by 15%? Or would you rather bring down the cost of your maintenance budget by minus 25%? Or maybe you want your logistics guy to cut the handling and booking efforts by minus 50%? I'm not a dealer of carpets, but I'm talking about the software that delivers that already today in Bosch factories. And this is the best-in-class process knowledge of 400,000 Bosch employees that we cast into software and deliver to you. And we deliver with a promise of a proven track record of KPIs and payback. So, dear ladies and gentlemen, if you want to manufacture like a Bosch, buy this software. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, excellent. This man did an excellent job in selling, and I think that's what it's all about. You know, if you go to the external world, we have to be selling, and we have to be selling like he did. I don't know whether I would buy a carpet from him, but I think he's really a good NextSeed seller. So all the best for the future. Thank you very much. Yeah. So that brings us to the end of this section. Thank you also. Big applause for Sven for coming.
Thank you.
And for you, the president, and please take a seat in the first
Thank
row.
You.
So, how are we moving on, Mette?
Yes, next up we're going to watch another movie. As you know, all this technology we're talking about now is very specialized and it's very complicated. And when things get complicated to explain, it's difficult to sell. We had a rather good job here, but maybe other people won't feel so comfortable about it. So we have been trying to tap into the emotions of the customers, putting another kind of commercial on the streets to explain the vision of the Factory of the Future a bit better. So let's watch it here. That's what the Factory of the Future sounds like.
Activity being delivered flawlessly and successfully. Want it to virtuality. Want it to virtuality.
Connectivity makes your company move. You want it, you need it. Connectivity. Yeah.
What do you need? Let's make things easy. Simplicity.
Did you like it?
Well, our next topic addresses how data has improved manufacturing. So we come to the third section, and I think that's an interesting topic. Huh?
Yeah, and it seems like everybody is talking about data these days. Are they not, Rolf?
Yeah.
So how to capture it, what to do with it when you have it, how much time will you need to process it, et cetera, et cetera.
But now, dealing with data means we have to acquire data in the first place. And we will show you how we do that at BBI in a very, very good context. What I have here is a so-called SCD. It's a special sensor made from BCDS. It's a very inexpensive three-way acceleration sensor with a light and a temperature function and a low-energy Bluetooth that lasts for years. Mette, can you catch that up?
I think you have to come a bit closer, because now it's searching.
I have to come closer, okay.
Yeah, Mette? Yeah, we see. Yeah. Hey! Managed. You see here the graph behind us?
So what we have here is a factory device that you can glue and attach to any machine in the world. You can set it up in seconds and have the result, and via our Industry 4.0 gateway, you can transfer it to your living room and control what's happening in the plant within hours.
Well, it's really easy capturing data, but what to do about it then?
Yeah, before I tell you what we could do with data, let's ask somebody who has really been working very hard on data. Mette, who's our next guest?
Yes.
Oh, just a moment, Bose.
Okay, I think I forgot something.
We first need to collect our customer's voice. Okay. It's very important. Okay. Yeah. So here, now let's take mobile phone and we use Slido. So you can type in www.slido.com in any browser, and then you enter the event code BCW19 and you go to stage A. There in the polls, you will see one of the questions as we show also here on the screen. So the question is about what is the main challenge in getting benefit from data from your point of view. We offer four selections: collecting data, analyzing data, data privacy concerns, this we don't need to explain anymore, customer understanding the value. Yeah. So please tell us what you think of by voting one option, and we will show you the result at the end of this session.
Excellent.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we won't let you wait any longer. Let's welcome our next guest on stage, Joerg Klinger. He's the Senior Vice President of Manufacturing Technology Systems and Data from Bosch Automotive Electronics. So let's see the introduction movie. Please welcome Joerg Klinger on stage. Welcome back.
Thank you for the introduction.
Welcome.
Hi.
All right. As we just saw in your introduction movie, you are kind of facing the full range of manufacturing challenges. You have almost 40,000 people in 15 countries, so you have high complexity, diversity, and volumes for production.
Yeah, so in manufacturing, actually, it's all about availability and transparency of data. So when I joined our division, we did the worldwide consolidation of our KPI reports in a manual way. So based on a very complex Excel tool, you can imagine the process was quite slow, and a fast reaction on deviations was nearly not possible. So our solution, first of all, we put really some effort into data structurizing and standardization, and second, in automizing of data collection and to visualize the data. And now, actually, all our KPI reports are available in near real time on our smart devices, and I can check my lines and even down to machines and processes worldwide whenever I need it.
Wow. It seems quite easy, but probably reality is a bit more complex, isn't it? Could you show us how it really works?
Yes, of course, it's complex, but you get it managed and under control if you do the structurizing and the standardization of the data. How it works, it's quite simple, and I can show you now in a quick animation.
Yes, please.
So you see our standard dashboard, and there we can actually select our manufacturing locations. You can go into a plant, select the lines, and there even you can go into one single day. You see the performance of your lines, you see the downtimes, and finally you even see the problems that caused the downtimes in a Pareto. And as you have seen it, it's in Hungarian language in that case, because the raw data will also be used by our people in the plant, by the colleagues, to work on their daily improvement PDCA cycles.
Wow.
So, and we have now access to this data every time, anywhere.
Very impressive. But does that mean that now you're spending your entire workday on your tablet?
Guys, I'm so enthusiastic. I'm looking into this tablet 24/7, basically. No, just kidding. So actually, it's the other way around. So it saves me a lot of time, and it makes me even more productive. Why? So how does it work? So we have set alarms in our application, which is focused on our current issues that we define. Yeah? So basically, the system is analyzing the data for me, and helps me to put my focus on the relevant deviations. And this we can do on all levels mm-hmm. in our organization.
OK. So that sounds nice, but what does it specifically mean for your organization?
So just imagine now, first of all, the formal reporting is reduced close to zero. So no Excel, no PowerPoint presentations anymore. Yeah? And we use the capacity that we have mainly for process improvement. And second, very important, so it's an enabler for the paperless production. Yeah, so it, and the paperless production on the other side is the enabler for a data-driven plant. So just imagine in our pilot plant in Wuxin, China, where we have already realized the paperless production, we save now 200,000 pages of paper already now per year. And this is also a significant aspect regarding environmental protection. No? And the third topic actually is that we now combine the real-time data with pattern recognition, which makes our problem solving much more efficient and faster than before.
Oh, theory sounds amazing. But I think that I and... would you like to hear a user case story here in the audience?
Yes, of course.
I think we would. Could you give us an example, Joerg?
Yeah, so of course I have one. Unfortunately, a quality issue that we had recently with one of our products. But guys, no worries, nothing that could be delivered out. It was a bent motor pin of one of our ECUs. And I think you see now the animation. The problem was not known. The root cause was not known. And it was coming from multiple potential parameters from the line. So in such a complex problem, even your experienced engineers, they need weeks to set up experiments to identify and isolate the root cause. Now our application actually uses predefined algorithms, analyzes all the data from our data lake, and identifies the main influencer that leads to the problem. Finally, the system is proposing us the most probable root cause, and this happens within minutes. Yeah?
Okay.
And actually, honestly, our engineers were in the beginning quite skeptical, because the system recommends a different root cause than they did. Yeah? But finally, they were convinced because the root cause was going in the right direction and the problem then finally was fixed and gone.
Okay. So to sum up your message, the system actually really works and it's doing a job now that the current methods wouldn't be able to solve.
Yeah, so actually it's increasing our problem-solving capability significantly. And also the experience now showed our engineers the value of data. And actually the big data now is augmenting our engineers to focus more on process improvement instead of using their time for executing experiments. And actually the best feedback that I received from one of our engineers was that he said, I do not want to go back into the old world. So he really recognized the value of data and he don't want to go back into this old mode. So I think that's actually the way how the digital transformation also in the plant will work.
That's amazing. So that's actually the proof that data-driven manufacturing is already out there, it's already working, and it's already making the manufacturing life in Bosch so much easier. Thank you so much, Joerg. I will let you go, Rolf. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Joerg. Please take a seat. I have some short questions to you. You have shown really impressively what you're doing with data, but seeing what you have done, what dynamics you have created, I can't imagine you stop here, but I think you probably advance, you have some more plans. What are your next steps?
So the next steps actually are already started. Yeah? So we go towards artificial intelligence and deep learning solutions and go for more and more autonomous systems.
And there's a question, and that was a question we didn't arrange before, by the way. Do you think that what you're doing in mass production could be also attributed to small volume production? Does this type of analysis make sense?
Of course it makes sense. Yeah? So if, let's say, if the process data, or let's say the process is independent from a high volume production or small volume production, and if you want to improve based on data, actually it makes no difference.
On the next steps that you have in mind, do you have an example of what you're doing next?
Actually, this morning you already heard from Michael Bolle and from Dirk Slammer about the VPAS. No? We have a similar case now in the electronics production. There we have a higher or a shorter tech time, different requirements. So VPAS is actually here not the fitting solution. But what we have now in electronics manufacturing, you can imagine we have our printed circuit boards where at the end we always need to make a picture from components, from the solder joints. And there we have millions of pictures actually stored. In the past, we did nothing with them, only in case of a quality problem. All this data is actually in a good labeled quality because an operator did the verification. And now we take this data, this labeled data, and we feed an AI algorithm to make this manual verification now automatic. And the first results that we see right now is that the workload for our operators is significantly reduced. And it's just a matter of learning time now of the system to get this manual workload completely eliminated.
I think it sounds very impressive. We have been talking about manufacturing a lot, but I think this type of data should also enable you to do more in the product lifecycle. For example, is there any influence or feedback you have on product development?
Yes, it's just imagine on this example what I just explained with our printed circuit boards. Now we take the deep learning results that we get in a closed loop between manufacturing and engineering actually to optimize then component lands and solder pads that finally we come to products that are designed by artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. This is possible. But as I mentioned before, so before that, we have to do our homework regarding data management. And from my point of view, everything which comes after is actually just execution.
Yeah, thank you very much, Joerg. I think big applause to him. I think you have shown us what you can do in the world of big data and manufacturing, improving quality, not only quality, but also productivity and the whole life cycle of a product. Please do me a favor when you get back to your colleagues from BCDS, extend them my best great thanks for developing this device, which we can need very, very well. And I think have a big hand for him. And then I think in the next step, we have the next guest.
Yes. So let's welcome our next guest on stage. And our next guest is proof that just keeping to the old standards and mindset is no longer optional. So our guest can tell us more about their experience with improving their business with data. So our guest is from Control to Go. Let's watch the introduction movie first. Please welcome on stage Alexey Belinsky, CEO of Control to Go.
Hey, great to see you, Alexey.
Thank you.
Alexey took all the long way from Moscow to come to us, and he will now explain how they bring innovation and data, modern technologies to our old product. And he gave me a present, which he then gave to my
Give me colleagues. 5 minutes and I'll present it to you.
Okay.
You'll have to wait, Rolf. Okay.
So
Sorry.
The stage is yours.
Thank
I'm
you, Rolf.
I'm interested to see what's happening.
Thank you. There has been many talks about predictive analytics recently, and I'm here not to tell you the theory. I just wanted to share with you our experience of implementing it in real life. Predictive analytics tends to be the major pillar of the factory of the future, but without implementation into the deep implementation into the business processes of the entire organization, it doesn't bring any value. I'll tell you about the case of implementing the predictive analytics into the Russian railways industry. As any given industry, it has its own specifics. In terms of Russian railways, it's 85,000 kilometers in length, 21,000 locomotives in operation. It's a huge number. It's different climate zones from severe Siberian winters to the subtropical climate in Sochi, and it has. Almost unpopulated landmass, so almost nobody live in the major part of Russia, and almost nobody want to live there. And this is unfortunately true. And what our client Locotec has in these circumstances, they have 100 depots, 150 points of locomotive service, 10 overhaul plants throughout the country. I'll tell you why Tinder is highlighted here on this map. Look at the video from our security camera. So you see the worker running not to perform his work. He's running out of a bear. it doesn't happen every day. But if it did, we would be prepared to this. But something unpredictable always happens with any business. And of course, the main source of predictability in the business of Locotech is not bearish. It's the age of fleet. It's very, very old fleet. The average age of the fleet is 26 years. Sometimes we deal with locomotives 40 years old. And this faces some challenges. So we face some challenges. The first main challenge is unbalanced workload at depots. Some of depots are empty. Some of depots are really full. And behind the wall, the queue of locomotives stays and waits to be serviced, wasting money and wasting time. The second challenge is the number of repairs, and especially the number of unscheduled repairs. This old fleet almost breaks down every day, many times. What have we done? The Control2Go portfolio company Clover Group has designed and implemented smart maintenance software products to 52 depots, covering 7,500 locomotives, and doing more than 250 manpower intensive repairs a day. And we did it in three steps. First step was modeling. Excuse me. We thought that if we get data, historical data, and analyze it, we would be able to predict when the machine broke down. This is not true. So it doesn't work in that way. The prediction would be not really accurate in this way. What we did, we hired a lot of physicists, a lot of engineers, let them sit nearby the mathematicians and coders and design the models, the physical models of the parts of locomotives and locomotives as a whole. And that's how we get the accurate prediction, from 85% to 95%. But this was not enough, because the company didn't know what to do with this knowledge. So they say, OK, we know when it breaks down, so what? What to do this with this? At step two, we integrated smart maintenance into the ERP system of Locotech. And now the system can order spare parts on its own, not involving people in this process. They order it 10 days prior to the repair, which has to be performed in a certain depot for a certain locomotive. But this was also not enough. There was a third step, because the first two stages didn't deal with the issue of the queues behind the wall of depot and the empty other depots. And we did the algorithm with prescripts, the optimal form, optimal schedule of coming to the repair. And all three steps did do the great job. I'm staying here at the stage of Factory of the Future, and obviously you can't repair a locomotive or any other big stuff in a garage, so you need a factory. What is the maintenance and repair factory of the future? It's data generated and shared between the machines and the equipment of the plant. It is automation of the shop floor and the headquarters. It is artificial intelligence, which makes decisions which is used to be made by the human. But the basis of all of this is prediction. Either machine or human have to know what will happen with their business in order to be prepared to the surprises. And that's what we do. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay, I think that was a wonderful presentation where we're not in the middle of the factory, but we saw how the factory and the prediction connects to the factory, but also to a completely different business model with a big expectation. Why did you focus on predictive analysis? What took you in this place?
You know, this was just an idea. When we had huge losses in Locotech, the billions of rubles with these unscheduled repairs, we had to do something with this. And we asked ourselves the question if we can predict when the machine breaks down. And we bought the share of the company which can deal with such algorithms, and finally we get a result.
And a second question, predictive analytics, you say it brings value to the industry. Are there more ideas that you see how it can bring value to the industry on top of what you've shown to us?
It's a huge value for any industry. I mean, when you use something, I mean, some technical stuff, which usually breaks down, this is value itself to know when it breaks down. Mm-hmm. Because every time when, in our case, locomotive breaks down, it drops the train, it goes to the depot, it is being repaired by the on account of a service company, and it produces losses. If we know when it breaks down, we can make more works, and it will be will not drop the train.
Okay.
Not cause losses.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I'm hearing in the background there's already some noise because maybe other sessions are closed already. We will stay absolutely cool and we will bring it to the end in time. So don't worry, you will get something to eat. Yeah?
Yes. So now let's have a look at the result from the live pool. As we can see on the screen, the result is quite obvious that most people vote for the option that customer understanding the data value seems to be the most challenging thing for them.
From my point of view, my experience now, we have to follow a certain sequence, and it starts with a proper data management, including the preparation, the labeling, the modeling of the data. Then it really becomes the value or gets the value, which also needs to be protected. And then afterwards, we need to set up the proper IT pipeline with the right computation power. So this is the basis. Before we are not doing that, we will not gain the value.
Alexey.
For us, it's very simple. So it's a try and buy approach. So we just do it on our own, and then clients gets the value and pays the money.
Yes. So what a show. But maybe we should just thank you all for also asking other questions in Slido. We couldn't really find the time to answer them here, but go to our booth after the show and talk to the experts there that can help you answer your questions. So thank you for the questions. But Rolf, we are not quite done yet.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm just having a test for you. I just want to find out if you have been paying attention during the latest 90 minutes. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
It's questions I'll ask and you answer true or false.
Okay.
I'll are we ready? Best, yeah. We start now. First question. The intelligent floor will become a vital part of the future factories.
True, we've seen it.
Yes. Additive manufacturing will become a standard technology in serial production.
True, also convincing arguments.
Good. The arena is home of the VfB Stuttgart.
That's probably false, but I don't make comments on VfB Stuttgart. I made some in the past, and I did it in Stuttgart, and that didn't work too well.
Yeah. You probably know it better than I. But the arena then brings together partners to realize Factory of the Future.
True.
Yes. So, Sven Hamann said that Bosch eat what they cook and serve the best meals to the external market.
I'm not sure whether I want my meals be cooked by him, but in reality, I think that's what they do. They use Bosch principles, so it's a true.
It's a true. All right, so you tested my catching skills just earlier on, catching the sensor to me.
Yeah.
I want to test you as well.
Okay.
So, let's see. Do you think he will catch it, true or false?
False.
Okay, we create a bigger distance, then you can make a bet, yeah?
Okay, let's see.
Oh, I'm
false.
Correct.
Sorry about that. Okay. But it can easily manage that. Okay, next question. Thanks to the utilization of data, Joerg Klinger from Bosch Automotive Aftermarket reduced 200,000 pages of paper each year in their Wujian plant.
True, and I think it's a big achievement because he also reduced a lot of bureaucracy.
It's amazing. And as we also heard, Alexey from Control2Go, he said that, or did he say, that bears love trains?
Probably true, but I'm not sure. Maybe it depends on what they're serving on board of the train. Yeah.
I guess that's true. Maybe the real question is, predictive analytics have already reduced train repair costs?
True.
True, yes. And the last question. So, data has enabled Liebherr to increase their product quality?
True, and it has done much more. It has improved the whole life cycle of the product, as we could see it.
Cool. All right, it's not bad. You have actually been paying attention.
Thank
Good
you
for you,
much.
You passed the Thanks. Test. So, just one thing left. I have just one last question. What's next then?
What's next? What's next is we will continue on the factory of the future. As you've seen, we will consequently implement it in the next years to come. But we obviously want to carry the whole energy and the whole dimension of going for the factory of the future and the whole company of Bosch in the whole manufacturing environment under the banner of manufacture like a Bosch.
That sounds pretty good to me.
Yeah. Woo!
I am Sean, and I approve this message.
You got it. Thank you very much.
Yep,
good man. Yeah. Go ahead.
See you next year.
So, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. That was it. I hope we come to the end in time. I think the two ladies did an excellent job. Big applause to the two ladies. We are in time. Yeah. We are customer connected. I can see it from the response that is coming out of the audience, so that worked also very well. We're happy to have you here. We hope you got some inspiration, you got some entertainment, you take away a lot of energy in the future. There's only one thing left. If you don't like it, go to Eric. But if you like it, go to him as well, because it was a wonderful idea. It was a wonderful experience for us to try out this experiment. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
A big applause for our host, Rolf Najork.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Super gemacht. Wow, you did it well. Yeah?